semi-comedian host who tells the stories of Americana and Lutheran, complete liberal, by the name of Garrison Keillor. And Garrison Keillor is still alive now, he's about 102 or something, but he's still doing this little radio show about America that doesn't exist, which he focuses on the aspects of Americana, Lake Wobegon, Minnesota. And in that church, he's a Lutheran, but in that town, there's a Catholic church. And the town doesn't exist, and he calls the church, the church is called, to him, the Lutheran, the Church of Our Lady of Perpetual Responsibility. It was a Catholic church in the 1950s. And one day he was walking by the Catholic church. He knew that all Catholics, of course, were bad, and they were evil. But the door of the church was open. It was during the week, and there was no one there. He said he was a boy, and he saw the Church of Our Lady of Perpetual Responsibility, and it was empty. And he said, you know, maybe I'll go in and see what they have in that evil Catholic church. He walked in, there was no one there. And then he looked around, and he saw the candles burning in front of statues. And he had never seen this kind of thing before, and he walked in further and further. And then he realized, you know what? I'm not in this church alone. He looked around and saw eyes in the stained glass windows. He saw eyes in the statues. And he said, I'm not alone. And I know what's going to happen. The priest is going to come. He's going to lock the door behind me and say, we've got another one. And so he was filled with total fear. And he ran out of the church. Now what is it that he, a complete liberal, a complete pagan, saw in the Catholic Church in the 1950s? We have also yesterday an historical event that one of our Catholics here just baptized not too long ago in the resistance for the very first time in his life attended Mass in a church. Don't get used to it. But it's ended life in the church. You have to have a Mass in the church. And so, what is it that Garrison Keillor saw? He went into an empty church. Another man, one of my former parishioners also, he converted to the Catholic faith by walking into an empty church. He also was a non-Catholic and knew the Catholic Church was bad and didn't like the church. But there was a church that was open. He walked in the city of America. And he saw the stained glass windows. He saw the red light next to the tabernacle. And he felt that he was not alone. He was on the verge of committing suicide and living a life of complete despair. He decided to walk into this church because being raised a non-Catholic, being raised a Protestant, he knew what all Protestants and the good old Protestants knew, that the only evil thing in the world is the Catholic Church. And he walked in to an empty church. There he found eyes in the window, like Garrison Keillor. There he found eyes in the statues. There he found a burning light, and he felt that there was life in this church. And he felt that there was never alone. Now we go to a church in our times, and there is total emptiness. And why is that? Well, today, a few considerations, in fact, stolen in part from the reading of Father Hugo last night in the sermon of Cardinal P, saying that what is the ecumenical and what is the true? The ecumenical says that things are non-living, but there is a true mother, and the other mother is the ecumenical mother. When that child was brought before Solomon, the one mother, the baby was not hers. And hence when Solomon said, cut the baby in half, it tells us in the book of Kings, and the mother said these words, the one mother, one woman said, let it be so. For let the baby be neither yours nor mine. And so the one mother, the one that was not the mother, when she heard the king's decree. Let the baby be cut in half. She said, let it be so. Let the child be neither yours nor mine. This is a secret dogma of ecumenism. And the secret dogma of liberalism. The liberal and the ecumenist say, well, there's truth in all religions. Every religion is okay. So you take part for you, I'll take part for me. You believe what you want to believe in, I'll believe in what I want to believe in. But why do they say this? The reason is because they're liars. The first ecumenists that we see in the sacred scripture in the New Testament is Pilate. And Pilate is approached by our Lord Jesus Christ. And our Lord Jesus Christ asks, art thou a king then? And Christ responds, thou sayest it. For this was I born, for this came I into the world, that I might bear witness unto the truth. Whoever is of the truth hears my voice. Whoever is of the truth hears my voice. A living voice. And this voice is the voice of Christ. We call our church, what do we call it? We call our church Holy Mother Church. What does a mother do? A mother carries a child. It comes from a father. And the mother protects the child. And the mother makes sure the child grows and waxes strong. And the mother makes sure the child doesn't lose any limbs, makes sure the child is fed. The mother is about the preservation and increase of life. And that life is one. What happened in the last 500 years inside the Catholic Church as a result of the horrible phenomenon, an evil thing known as Protestantism, that entered the world 500 years ago, is that somehow faith became unliving. Somehow faith became a collection of dogmas, like a collection of pieces of wood. You go to a lumber yard, you can buy wood, take some of the wood and make it into a chair. Take other wood and make it into a table. Take other wood and make it into a house. It's just wood. You do that with a living tree, it instantly dies. It's no longer alive. But wood is dead. So it can be cut. It can be used for many purposes. It can be stored and left alone. It's just wood. The tree has to be watered. The tree has to receive the sun. The tree needs insects to live around it that it might have its life. Insects are important for the life of trees. A tree must have its roots into the ground. A tree requires a lot of maintenance. Because a tree is alive. The difference between the Catholic today and the Catholic of 500 years ago and the Catholic before is that to the Catholic before, our faith was alive. It's one life. Now, it's a collection of dogmas. It's just a collection of beliefs. And everybody has beliefs. Some people believe in the boogeyman. Some people believe in Buddha. We believe in Christ. It's just a belief. What is the secret dogma behind it all? It's contained in the Book of Kings. Father P. gave the example in the reading Father read yesterday that there's a true mother and then there's the false mother, the ecumenical mother. The mother that says Christ can be divided. You can have the top half of him. We have the bottom half. But what does it say in the Book of Kings? She knew what it meant. If we divide the baby, there will be no baby. If we divide the baby, there shall be only rotting and decaying flesh. Therefore the woman said, let the baby be divided, so that I shall neither have a child nor thee. She once had a child, and her child is dead. And this is the state of every soul, the state of mortal sin. They had a child. They had the divine life. They had the truth. And then they killed it. They killed it. And then they see others who have a child, and their child is alive. They have the divine life. You see it today, for instance, whenever a man of the world sees someone living an upright life, sees someone living according to the gospel, sees someone living according to the law of God, they are filled with being. Let him be cut in half. And hence modern laws are made against Christianity, and only against Christianity. Against Christ, and only against Christ. We don't have laws that say you cannot put a menorah in an airport. But there are laws that say you cannot put a creche in an airport. We don't have laws that say you cannot express false religions in public. In the Denver airport, they play the American Indian music because they claim that there was some chief buried there at the airport 2,783 years ago, and therefore it's sacred land. And so therefore they sing this demonic music on the speaker above Concourse A and the first Concourse A in the main terminal. They say, well, we have to do that. They play 24 hours a day. But there's no supposed to be a separation of church and state. We're not supposed to promote any religion. If it's a pagan religion, no problem. But if it's Christ, it must be cut in half. Because everyone knows that St. Augustine spoke the only truth about religion. And St. Augustine said there are two loves and not three. These two loves built two cities and not three. And the two loves were the city of the love of self and the city of the love of God. The love of God builds only one city. The love of self builds a city for self. The love of God builds a city for God. And this is the city of God, and he writes about it. The city of God is founded by our Lord Jesus Christ. The city of God was created in the very beginning of time. The first human head of the city of God was Adam. The final head of the city of God was St. Peter II, the final pope. And this city of God will exist from the beginning of time, when it started with the creation of Adam, until the very end of time. And it is a city of the love of God, which is to be built on this earth. The city of the love of God. What is it that makes our city sacred? The city of the love of God, not the city of the love of man. So what we have is a world in which the love of God is being wiped out. And even Catholics, we're supposed to know, love, and serve God. Catholics are seeing the truth only as something dead. It's not dead. It's alive. You go into a church before Vatican II. You go into a church like this one, and you see life. You go into a modern church, and you see death. It is visible. They are sterile. They are cold. They are empty. In fact, it's interesting now. It's quite noticeable when you see the throwback churches. We have now churches built in very recent years, which have old characteristics. One of them, for instance, built by Cardinal Burke, who's now very famous. Cardinal Burke, because the American cardinal was anti-liberal, and he was going to be exiled by Pope Francis to the island of Guam, in the middle of nowhere, to minister to the Dooneybirds. And so Cardinal Burke, being punished because he questioned the Pope, he built a big and beautiful basilica in La Crosse, Wisconsin, just south of La Crosse, actually only about a 40-minute drive from our old seminary in America. Massive place. He tried to build it in the style of like a Roman basilica. But if you go into it, you'll see marble floors, you'll see the dome, and you'll see the walls. It reminds you of a Roman basilica. It reminds you a little bit of St. Peter's in Rome. But what stands out when you walk into this building is that it's like a mausoleum. It's cold and it's dead. They're trying to build it in the old style, even though for the new mass. Try to build it with beautiful color. Try to build it in such a way that it would look a lot like an old style church. And there are many churches actually being built like this throughout the world. At least some. The United States, I'm sure over here as well. Building some of these throwback churches, like 1950s diners that are being remade in the United States. They put the red plastic covers, so it looks like a 1950s diner, only it's not a 1950s diner. They're still serving modern food, which they didn't serve in the 50s. They're serving modern people who know nothing like the 1950s, but he looks a little bit like the 1950s, kind of. And so they're doing that at the Catholic Church. But the first thing you notice when you walk in, it's sterile. It looks like a mausoleum. It's dead. Why is that? Because the faith is one. And the faith is alive. And the faith is a seed that comes from the Father. And it must grow inside of us. And it must be watered. And it must be cared for. It is one. It is living. It is undivided. It is not a collection of beliefs. It is one and undivided. Now, what is the effect in our lives when we recognize the faith is one and the faith is alive? One of the first automatic effects, when you are walking and you cut your finger, the immediate reaction is to remove your hand back. Put a band-aid on it. Treat it delicately. Because we don't want to be cut. And why do we not want to be cut? Because we are alive. If we were dead, you can take stone and cut it into pieces. You can take wood and cut it into pieces. It's no problem. But because we are alive, we don't allow this. The more living faith is to us, the more alive it is, the more sensitive we are to every attack against the truth. We see people who have diabetes, they lose their sensitivity. They can no longer feel their feet. They can even cut their feet and not make it, not know. Father Kramer, for instance, was going to come to our first conference in August of 2012 with Resistance. And on the way to go to the airport, he cut his feet. And he didn't know it. And he was walking around the apartment in Ireland, and as he was cutting, he realized blood was all over the carpet. His feet were all cut to pieces. He didn't even know it. Then he had to tape his feet up. So that if the more that we go to death, the less our feeling is, the less our sensitivity is. The more we go to life, the more our feeling is, the more our sensitivity is. And what we must recognize as Catholics in our times, our faith is alive, the truth is alive, it is one, it is undivided, and we must love it. One thing about a living thing, if it is not loved, it will die. It must be fed, it must be nourished. We must recognize that our faith is alive, and it must be loved. Our faith must be nourished. Therefore, we say our prayers each day. Therefore, we read the Catechism and do study of our faith. There will we read and hear a few things about the life of the saints and the things of God. Because our faith is alive, and we want to keep it alive. We want the spirit of that faith to enter inside of us and to grow. Now, as the faith grows, you will notice that it doesn't add fingers. It doesn't add toes. It doesn't add heads. It simply increases. So likewise, as our faith grows, there can be no new dogmas. And if our faith is growing, there's no removal of fingers, no removal of toes. And hence, there is no removal or diminishing of truth. And how are we to treat that faith? As members of Holy Mother Church. And as members of Holy Mother Church, we love the truth. We carry it in our arms. We may be protected from the attacks of the enemies, from the attacks of insects, the attacks of bugs, from the attacks of disease, from the attacks of the outside. And we may be grown to wax strong. And we're very careful in our presentation of it. And that is why our ancestors, they were not told what to do. When they came out of persecution, St. Peter never said Mass in a church. St. Peter never said Mass in a church. Because of the time of persecution. But when the Mass was able to be said in the church, what happened? Immediately they added things to it because it's alive. Stations appeared on the wall. But if you look at those stations, they're the 14 stations of the death of Christ. Stained glass windows began to appear. And if you look at those stations, the windows, you will discover that they are the stories of sacred scripture and the stories of the saints. And they tell us what is in the Mass. And there's nothing new in it. And arches began to appear, calling us to God. The Roman arch, which we consider as God protecting us. God coming down and protecting us. And God reaching down and protecting man. And we depend everything from him. The Gothic arch, says a different focus of man lifting his mind and heart to God. And every single thing in the church calls to our faith. Everything in it speaks of something which is already in the gospel, already in the creed, and there is no addition, and there is no subtraction. There is only a growth, and paint appears on the walls. Reverend doses rise behind the altar, all of them speaking of the Christ. One altar that we received in Colorado, about a 40-foot tall altar that we got from a church in Chicago that was sold by the Catholic Church. And then they all had this, this scene of the Annunciation on one side, the Resurrection on the other, and the Crucifixion, of course, in the middle. And the Annunciation scene, when they showed it, sold the church, when the prisoners came and took out the Annunciation scene of marble and brought it to his house to save it from the Protestants and the church was sold to. Couldn't take much else. When he found the church was sold, not a traditional Catholic, and that the altar was going to go back into a Catholic church, he found us. Said, I have a piece of marble that goes to your altar. And he brought it back. So the altar was complete again. Because the faith is living. And the faith grows and increases. And the faith gives life. And what is happening to souls today is that we are not considering that in our hearts. And if the faith has given life, what does Christ say? What is his command? Increase and multiply. Hence there must be inside of us the fire to spread that divine truth, the fire to spread that divine love, and a fire that with passion fights against any attack against that divine truth and against that divine love. Because the child cannot be slain. Which is why Cardinal P says in his commentary, the true mother, when she realized the child was going to be cut in half, and the true mother, when the child was going to be killed, the true mother said, let the child live. Let the child live. Because their focus was on the child. So likewise, if we are Catholics, and we are followers of Christ, we must focus on the child, which is our Lord Jesus Christ, the living and divine truth, who is in my breast, who is in my heart, who is in my soul. And if anything attacks that truth, we defend it. If we are cut in half, no problem. But that truth cannot be cut in half. Our focus is only on that, and that that truth cannot be lost. And that no matter what, we are ready to give up anything, so long as that truth is preserved. That mother was ready to give up the life that she longed to live with that child. She was ready to give up the name of the child being after her name. So long as the child lived. We must therefore be ready to give up anything to preserve our Holy Roman Catholic faith. And this cannot be done if we don't realize it is alive. It must be loved, it must be nourished, it must be increased, and it must be the central focus of all of our life. And then we can never fall into the trap of ecumenism. And even pagans recognize that. Like there is a healer walking into the church. This church is different. I don't see a priest. I don't see people in the church. But I have eyes looking at me everywhere. There's a burning candle. And there is life here, and this church is never empty. A church that has faith is never empty. And a church without faith is always empty. And we must make sure that the true faith is in us. And therefore we have to fight hard for it. What do the enemies say? Why do you fight over faith? Why do you fight over faith? All that matters, for instance, amongst us in Catholic tradition, all that matters is the Latin Mass. What difference does it make about faith? The Mass is the center of the faith. And without the faith, the Mass has no place. It only belongs inside of the faith. It doesn't belong anywhere else. Heretics celebrate the Mass. The enemies of God celebrate the Mass. I met a priest in the Philippines who told me he hated the Latin Mass. But he was told by his bishop to say it, so he said it for the people that wanted it. Another one told me he didn't believe in the real presence. He didn't believe Christ was there. But he said the Latin Mass. And so, is it just about the Mass? No. It's about the faith. And so the faith is what we preserve. And part of preserving the faith means we preserve the Latin Triduum Mass. Part of preserving the faith means that we have all the children that God sends us. Part of preserving the faith is that ladies dress like the Blessed Virgin Mary. They wear dresses. Mothers stay at home. Part of the faith is that men are the head of the family. Part of the faith is that we follow the Ten Commandments. And to us, since the faith is alive, we accept all the truth and we reject the error of evolution. We reject the errors condemned by the Church. Many mockingly say that we accept the teaching of the Church about Galileo. The Church says that to say that the sun moves, or the sun rather does not move, is the center or out of the earth and its movements, is a heresy. That's what the Church said in 1616. Turns out science backs it up. But that doesn't matter. We know it is true because the Church says it. We know it is true because Sacred Scripture teaches it. And why does it matter? Because the faith is a one living thing. And all the teachings matter, not just some of them. The teaching about evolution being baloney. The teaching about Adam being the father of the entirety of the human race. The teaching of Jesus Christ is true God and true man, rose from the dead. But as Pope Leo XIII says, there is no difference between the Catholics' belief that Jesus Christ rose from the dead and Abraham had two sons. We believe Abraham had two sons because God says it, and he speaks only truth. And he speaks perfect truth, and he accepts only perfect truth. So if he says Abraham had two sons, he had two sons. If the Son of God became man, the Son of God became man, died on the cross for our sins. There are 12 sons of Israel. We believe all these things. And they are important to us because the faith is alive. Once the faith becomes only a collection of dogmas, then there's important ones and unimportant ones. Like in a house, there's structural beams, and then there are secondary beams. You can take out the secondary beams, just don't touch the structural ones. But when the faith is alive, you can say, well, you can cut off my arm as long as you don't take out my heart. No problem. But if the faith is alive, you say, no, you cannot cut off my arm. You cannot cut off my fingers. Everything matters. And we must ask the love of faith. And without the love of faith, we will not be given the grace to be martyrs. It's the most wonderful grace. Perhaps one day we can receive. But if we do not love the faith with all our hearts, we cannot receive this grace. If we don't love the faith with all our hearts, it won't grow. It won't increase. It won't wax strong. We have to love it. Not only quote-unquote believers. So let's pray for this love to be deep in our hearts and then spread it as far as it can. So thank God bless you all, and the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.